A stimulating topic, the theory of everything. So I guess in 2 hours, and a bit more if we want to be real, in 2 hours, you will know everything about everything. Thank you very much.
No pressure.
And I had a request from Jean-Sébastien that you interfere when you like, don't hesitate in asking him questions during the presentation. I think he will insist on this. But we are here to have a dialogue. And dialogue is a radical, important part of the integrative theory, integral theory. So I propose that we make room to Sebastian just now. And many thanks to Sebastian. Have a very good seminar. And teach us.
Thank you very much, Laurent. Thank you very much for coming. It's a real pleasure to be here at the Chair of Complexity. I remember some of the first seminars I attended, and I didn't imagine that one day I would be presenting here. So thank you very much, Laurent and Cathy, to organize everything for this seminar.
It is a honor for the chair.
It's a real pleasure, and first I'd like to, before I dive into some of the details, I'd like to say the way that I would like us to share this time together. So instead of me just presenting this theory of everything, it will be about us interacting and constructing together these 2 hours. So feel free to interrupt, to ask questions, if you have any doubts, or if my English sometimes is too fast or not clear enough, feel free to interrupt or to ask for translation. So it all started in South Africa. It all started in South Africa. 2 years ago, I was visiting my aunt Olga, and she was she's a psychotherapist, and we were having discussions about psychology, politics, even spirituality or ecology, and so on. And she recommended me one book. She said that I should have a look at this book called Integral Psychology. And she said that basically this book explains how all the various psychological models can be assembled into one way to understand the human psyche. So I was amazed, but it took me a few months to buy the book and read it cover to cover, and I was really amazed. And this is the first time when I discovered Ken Wilber. So we'll dive into Ken Wilber's thought. Ken Wilber is this American philosopher who has this madness into trying to understand the world and trying to understand how everything fits together. So, before we start, I'd like to make a personal claimer. Usually you have disclaimers, but I'm going to make a personal claimer. So first of all, this is the way I perceive integral theory, so it's going to be a subjective presentation. It's not how it is, it's just my understanding of Wilber's understanding of integral theory. And you'll have your understanding of integral theory by the end of the presentation. So I'll do my best to be as accurate as possible. Hi. But I'll also, I might make mistakes along the way. It's not going to be a perfect presentation. So if I make mistakes, feel free to correct me, or if you have a different point of your opinion, feel free to share it. I'll also do my best to separate Wilber's views from my own views. And this is some precautions I like to take. The question is, why is it so important to talk about integral theory before we even say what integral theory can be? First of all, we see that we evolve in a more and more complex world. Things are getting more complex. The world is evolving, humanity is evolving as well, and today you have millions of choices of what you want to do, what you can do, what are the options. If you think about the generation of our parents or our grandparents, not even talking about cavemen, for example, cavemen lived in a less complex world. They couldn't decide on, do I want to take EasyJet, do I even want to go on a holiday, and so on. The world is becoming more complex, And humans also want to understand the world. We want to know what's happening and how it's happening. So increasing complexity. Also, we have this sensation that some of the different fields that try to understand the world are disconnected. Some, let's say you're a scientist and you're into science. You might think that science is incompatible with religion because religion is about dogma and believing in something, whereas you think that science is simply about knowing what's happening and experimenting. So we have the impression that some fields can be disconnected from each other. We also have another problem is that the challenges for humanity are dramatically big and complex. If you think about global warming, pollution, some dramatic wars, or even the mixture or the meeting of various cultures pose problems that were not existing 100, 200, 1,000 years ago. And this is the increase in complexity. So we have a challenge of trying to get a holistic view if you want to understand the globality. Try to get the big picture instead of the small little pieces of the puzzle. Let's try to assemble the big puzzle together. And in researching the conference and how I would explain things, I was trying to find out a way to sum up the problem, what the core problem is. But it was not really easy for me to say, but what's the real issue behind that? So I simply took Edgar Morin's Introduction to Complex Thought, Introduction à la Pensée Complexe, and Edgar Morin explained in 5 sentences what I had difficulty to explain. So if you all agree, I would like to read just this little extract in French, if it's all right for everybody.
Okay. Is it okay?
Is it okay for everyone?
Yeah.
So, he talks about l'intelligence aveugle. Blind intelligence. Une prise de conscience radicale nous est nécessaire. Premièrement, la cause profonde d'erreur n'est pas dans l'erreur de fait, fausse perception, ou l'erreur logique, incohérence, mais dans le mode d'organisation de notre savoir en système d'idées, théorie, idéologie. Deuxièmement, il y a une nouvelle ignorance liée au développement de la science elle-même. Troisièmement, il y a un nouvel aveuglement lié à l'usage dégradé de la raison. Quatrièmement, les plus graves menaces qu'encourt l'humanité sont liées au progrès aveugle et incontrôlé de la connaissance, armes thermonucléaires, manipulation de tous ordres, dérèglement écologique, etc. Je voudrais montrer que ces erreurs, ignorance, aveuglement, péril ont un caractère commun qui résulte d'un mode mutilant d'organisation de la connaissance, incapable de reconnaître et d'appréhender la complexité du réel. So Morin basically says that it's not about knowing, it's about how you organize your knowledge. And this is what Wilber does with his integral theory. And this is the core issue of this seminar. So now we understand why we should do this. We're going to see what is the central question. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, as you proposed to me in the theory, you alluded to something which is very interesting. It's, I understood, but maybe it's wrong, that complexity increases because we want to explain. In other words, should we abandon the desire to explain, complexity would diminish?
I would say that there are 2 factors that lead to the increase of complexity. First is an objective factor, which would be that, for example, a caveman doesn't have much choice about what he can do in his life because he doesn't have all the technologies and the possibilities that we have today. So a caveman has more limited possibility than a human living today. But also there's the subjective part that a human today might want to understand this complexity, whereas the caveman didn't ask himself as many questions as the human today. And this can be correlated to the development of the brain, but we'll talk about that later. So I don't know if it answers your question or if it...
I interpret as yes, I mean less complexity when people don't want to understand.
Yeah, don't want to understand, and the world is not as complex.
So we would like to control it so it's complex?
Yeah.
Okay.
Makes total sense. So now that we have seen why it's important to look at this integral theory, how are we going to do this? And how did Wilber do it? Actually, Wilber found out that if you focus on all the details, you cannot derive any rule from anything, because you're looking at all the exceptions and you cannot derive the rule. You cannot have a theory that is 100% true in every circumstance, at least not when we are talking about knowledge. And we'll see later that Wilber distinguishes relative truth from absolute truth. So if you want to understand the big trends, you need to get a level to get the overall map. So you need to increase your level of awareness in order to see what is happening. So this is not going to be about all the details and all the exceptions about the rules. These are going to be sort of mega trends to understand how things work. And he did that using the technique of orienting generalizations. And you can see that in his different works. So now what are we going to talk about? Actually, before I tell you what we're going to talk about, I'm going to tell you what we're not going to talk about. So first, this is the integral theory that has been framed, and many people have elaborated criticism on the theory, saying things that don't work, things that are maybe not solid, or that we don't have enough evidence to prove that they're right or correct. But this is a 2-hour seminar, and we're going to make it as interactive as possible. So if we had a 4-hour seminar, maybe I would present the criticism. This is just an introduction. It's an overview. And second thing I'll not go into is the depth of the theory. So we're going to look at the surfaces and how the theory works overall, and not work into all the micro details and how things work in a very deep level. Okay. Unless we get into that in discussions. So now what are we going to talk about? First, I'm going to make a brief summary of the history of humanity and how humans evolved and how their way of perceiving the world evolved. So that will give us the context, which brings us to today. And then this will bring us to the second part, where we will see how integral theory solves some issues that humanity did not manage to solve in the previous years of its history. And then it's really interesting to know about theory, and I love theory, reading about fantastic ideas, but we're all practitioners here, and we're in a business school, and we also want to learn how we can apply these theories in the world. So this will be the third part, where we focus on real life examples and how some people have used integral theory to build on some concrete projects.
You talk here about, you talked about relative truth and absolute truth. So here, if I understand you well, you talked about how you did a theory. So is using consensus, is using what is agreed upon amongst scientific artists and people to try to make a whole theory, getting rid of relativism? I mean, getting rid of there is no truth, or does the truth exist, or things like that, right? Is it right? Is it the point of Wilber?
Absolutely. So when we'll be talking about relative truth, we will see in the history of ideas and how humans understand their own way of knowing the world, that scientists, or even some people who are what we would call relativists, will say that everything depends on everything, or you cannot say anything about knowledge, because if you really look deep inside, you cannot know things. But we'll see how Wilber goes beyond these views to propose a theory that would include this truth in a bigger picture.
Okay.
But that's already getting into the depth of the first part. Okay. So, history has evolved through various epochs and stages. Okay. And we know that we as humans started as basically cavemen to end up as we are today, in a world where we can do many things with technology that cavemen didn't have. But what we are going to look at are not only the biological evolution, but also the cultural evolution and the evolution of thought. How human beings develop their thought through time. And here, what philosophers or historians like to use as a framework is the idea that first humans were in a pre-modern era, before modernity, and then they shifted into something called modernity, and then after modernity, moved on to post-modern. So of course, even among specialists, there are huge debates about what really modernity is or post-modernity is. But here, we're using orienting generalizations to try to get the big picture and get the big ideas. So basically, in the pre-modern world, we could imagine the Spartan warrior, but actually it starts with the caveman evolving and societies being first hunter and gatherers and then moving into agriculture. And Wilber is trying to analyze and to understand what did humanity succeed in doing and what were the problems by being a pre-modern. So basically, the pre-modern will just see, for example, a dot, and his way of thinking will be, because God put it here, and that's the way it's always been. And when you think about this way of looking at things, that's the way that people who are much into traditional think. Traditional cultures or traditional people will think it's always been like that, and that's how it should be. So basically, humanity managed to secure their survival. And also, Wilber says that humanity founded something else that was really important. And this is what he calls perennial philosophy. Basically, perennial philosophy is a philosophy that explains that every religious tradition is just a different expression of one same truth. So for example, there would be one God, but every religion would try to explain the God from a different perspective. And this is the basic of perennial philosophy. And Wilber says that's a good thing humanity developed. But he says that there were also a lot of problems. For example, patriarchy, which means that there was a lot of domination and that societies were ruled by men and the masculine, and to oppress the feminine and women in the pre-modern societies. So this led to highly polarized female roles. Men did the hunting and the gathering, or they were warriors, and females were just staying in the cave, taking care of the kids, or gathering little food on bushes. There was another thing that Wilber says was really something that humanity needed to change, to evolve, was ethnocentric morality. So behind this complicated word, it simply means that you're going to be a good person with the people who you identify from the same group. So if I'm a Spartan, I'm going to be moral with other Spartans, but of course someone who was a Greek or a barbarian, I could just kill him because his life had no value to me. Or if I was from a particular religion, if I was a Christian, it was totally okay to go and slaughter Muslims because he's not from my group. And Wilber doesn't put any moral judgment on this. He just explains that that's the way it was. But hopefully, humans grew into a new mode of seeing the world. So this is the modern world. So I represented with a scientist, but actually we could trace back the beginning of modernity with, for example, with the Renaissance and humanism and the use of rationality. So the modern will say, onwards and upwards with inevitable progress. So progress was the main focus. They were not looking at the past anymore to say how to determine the future, but looking at how we want to get to a new direction. And of course, Wilber said there was a lot of progress during this stage of modernity. For example, the rise of democracy that didn't exist before, the end of slavery, the increase in lifespan, the use of machines and technology, for example. And the use of machines changed something in the cultures. That changed the gender roles from men being the force of power to produce, and women not being as strong, now we're able to produce thanks to machines. So it started to change the way that humans related with their work. And something that Wilber says was critical in modernity was the rise of empirical science. Empirical science being the fact of looking at facts and not necessarily believing at myths. In pre-modern, you believe in what your father tells you, what the leaders of the tribe tell you. In pre-modern, you're going to develop your own rationality and sense of criticism to believe, is it really true what my father told me? Is it really true what all my tribe tells me? And use this as a mode of reasoning. And there are two really critical points for Wilber in modernity that were really positive for humanity. The first is the fact that for the first time in history, humans, or some humans, started to develop a world-centric morality. World-centric means that my morality is not anymore delimited to the people of my tribe or my clan or my nation, but it's going to go to everybody in every human being on this planet. And this was the rise of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, for example. It's universal, it's not just for France or for the United States of America and so on. And the last element is the differentiation of arts, morals, and science. So that's an important point for Wilber. In pre-modern times, you had basically, for example, the clergy defining what was good or what was bad, morality, and you just followed the rules. And as for arts, it was all religious arts because the churches had the money to finance the art, and church decided what art was beautiful and what was not beautiful. And as for science, I take the example of a church, but we could use other examples in other cultures. They explain how the world works. So the world was created in 7 days, and that's written in the Bible, and that's unquestionable. In the modern world, we say, yeah, you're religious, so you can maybe dictate what morality would be. But science is something different, and we can try to find another way of knowing if it was true that the earth was created in 7 days. And arts, we can find new ways of producing art and experimenting art that maybe don't agree with religion, for example. But Wilber said that humans went too far. By differentiating arts, morals, and science, they actually dissociated the three. So if I'm a human in the modern world, I'm not going to say only that you should differentiate arts, morals, and science. I'm going to say that they have nothing to do together and they should be totally separate. And this, Wilber says, it's a mistake. And also, when you're too much using scientific reason, this is what Wilber calls flatland. So you create a world that has no more enchantment, that is just bound by rules, by norms, by rationality, by numbers, by calculus, and you leave no more space to the interiors and the subjectivity and what someone can feel and think. And finally, the denial of spirit. Because you're a scientist, you might reject everything that religion has to say, and so you'll end up denying spirit. Our last step, I chose the hippie as a figure of postmodernism, because the hippies were a movement, of course, in the late 60s, and we see that postmodernism as an epoch, as a historical epoch, will be maybe starting maybe in the 1950s, mainly in the West, so in Europe, especially in France and in the US. And actually, a postmodern would not view the world with rationality, but simply with interpretation. Everything is subject to interpretation, and everything is subject to your own subjectivity. And my truth is my truth, and your truth is your truth, and you can believe whatever you want, I can believe whatever I want. And so, on some levels, it's a really great thing, Wilber says, because it's pluralism. That's what makes us be all together. Here in ESSEC, we have international students, and it's really great to have all these views being together. it leads to contextualism, so you're not just going to think as things as being absolute and true all the time, but you're going to say, oh, it depends on the situation, sometimes yes, sometimes no, or you're going to try to look at the big picture. And most of all, what Wilber says is critically important is the new paradigm of knowledge. New paradigm of knowledge, before we try to understand what the new is, let's look at the old paradigm. For the moderns, they looked at the world as me as a subject looking at an object. So me, Jean-Sébastien, I'm looking at this remote control, and I'm just looking at it, and I have my subjectivity, and it's totally inexistent from the picture, which means that I'm looking at this remote control, but it doesn't really matter if I'm looking at it or if someone else is looking at it. It's just one reality of a remote control. What postmoderns said that is that actually it totally changes the story if I'm looking at it or if, for example, Mathieu is looking at the remote control. So we don't really realize that easily, so I'm going to share a story with you to see how that can influence. So I was giving a training in Iran, and I was showing a video to the trainees. And in this video, there were two people interacting. And then I asked a question about the video. And the trainee who answered said, yes, in the video, the old guy does this, and the young guy does that. And I was really surprised that he used the terms old guy or young guy, because what I saw in the video, and when I described the video, without being a racist, but I just described the black guy does this and the white guy does that. So to me, it's a black guy interacting with a white guy. For him, it was an old guy interacting with a young guy. So we don't see the same, we see the same reality in some way, but our cultural background or our story or whatever makes us see the world in a certain way, and that's very postmodern. So Wilber says it's really important to take subjectivity in account and the fact that we construct our world more than our world constructs us. So if you look at Hegel or Immanuel Kant or other philosophers, they have this idea. So basically Hegel said that it's like leaving out the map maker when you're trying to make a map of the world. If I'm trying to draw a forest, I'm drawing the forest with my perspective and so on, but in the map it's not included that the paper I'm using comes from the trees of the forest. And that's the interaction we need to keep in mind when we're dealing with complexity theories, in my opinion. But the problem is, if you go too far into all that, you're going to go into nihilism. Basically saying that if you're really an extreme nihilist, you're going to say that nothing exists and reality doesn't even exist. Some philosophers are specialized in theories like this. Or excessive relativism, saying that, oh, it's okay to decapitate someone because it's his culture and it's totally okay. And he will say that, yeah, you're an artist, you cannot understand what I'm saying as a scientist. I'm talking about real stuff. Or you might say, no, I'm an artist, you cannot understand because you're just in your numbers and you cannot understand my art. So far so good? Because I know some of these concepts are really not easy, so if you need more explanation or anything. So far so good? Yeah?
I just have a problem with that, is that it's linear in time. And for me, like, all the three of them just, you know, overlap.
Fantastic. So you already have some integral component into your way of thinking.
Yeah.
And that's exactly the thing. When I went to school, I remember in France we use, you know, the frise chronologique, so you know history in a linear way. And you're bringing up a really good topic because we're looking at it from a, let's say, modern or postmodern perspective. So I chose these glasses because they look kind of what I think is postmodern, in a way that we're looking at it from a particular angle. But now we're going to change our glasses. And we're going to use these Google glasses, which would be integral glasses, for example, and get a broader view on reality. So you bring up a really important point here. History is not necessarily linear. So we'll see what we keep from pre-modernity is the perennial philosophy, the fact that we're all expressing the same truth in our own way, in our own subjectivity, and a concept which is called holons. So let's look at what are holons exactly. So holons are like Russian dolls. You have one Russian doll, a very small one, and you're going to use a bigger Russian doll. You're going to put it in a bigger Russian doll, and you're going to have Russian dolls at the infinite. So reality is not composed of processes. Reality is not composed of matter. Reality is not composed by culture or the mind or electric stimuli, whatever. Reality, every reality is composed of holons. Every aspect of reality. So holons have something very special. When you look at the Russian doll, every Russian doll contains all the smaller Russian dolls inside. And the Russian doll can be enveloped or can grow into a bigger Russian doll as well. So you don't have the collection of Russian dolls aligned one after the other, and when you have the big one, you forget about all the others. You're going to use all the Russian dolls one to the other. And here it sounds pretty theoretical, but we'll see how what implications this has on our understanding of reality. If you want some references, you can look at Arthur Koestler's work, The Ghost in the Machine, which is really interesting when you think about, for those who are into philosophy, the problem of body and mind. Is my mind connected to my body? Is it a different entity? Or is my mind not real and my body real? If you're asking yourself these questions, you can find answers in The Ghost in the Machine. But as you see, we're talking about holons. Actually, we see that the modern incorporates the pre-modern. If you want to get a good, healthy, integral view of things, you should not say that cavemen were just barbarians or whatever. You're going to use what you want about the pre-modernity and incorporate it of your way of being today. So you are going to use perennial philosophy and you are going to include it in modernity. And you are going to be able to differentiate between arts, morals, and science as well. This is what you want to keep from modernity, for an integral perspective. And then, for the postmodern, you want to keep the integration of arts, morals, and science. First step is to differentiate, being able to distinguish, something that was really important for, that is important for Edgar Morin as well, to be able to distinguish, but integrate them. And uses this new paradigm also, saying that the world is not only how, it's not only a sort of real world that I understand, it's also, I understand from my perspective, my culture, my history, my psychology, and so on, as who I am as a being, and I'll not have the same understanding as another person. And you'll integrate all this into an integral framework. And now we'll see how we can dive into what really integral is. Now we know that we need to use these various elements from the various epochs of humanity.
Maybe one way to go beyond the relativism is to integrate that precisely our understanding of reality is part of reality.
Absolutely.
The way we understand shapes realities.
Absolutely.
It's part of it. So it's not exactly relativism, it's a more integrated truth. Would you follow that?
Yes, I totally concur with that. I would say that, first of all, knowing that what you know is relative helps you, because it's not about being right or wrong, it's about sharing your own subjectivity. Just like me in this conference, I know I'm not explaining you how it works. I'm giving you my perspective on integral theory. And the second thing is also being able to know that, according to Wilber, and that's a view that Wilber convinced me of, is that there is an absolute truth and that there are realities that can be known, but this pertains to the domain of the spiritual. And we'll talk about that later, maybe. But Wilber, he's not only a philosopher, but he is also a deep mystic. And a great part of his work is to say that maybe in modernity, people have been disgusted by religion because of the dogma and some mythic beliefs, but you can have a healthy or your own approach, not to religion, but to spirituality, to connecting to something bigger. And that's something that Wilber really inspired me on a personal level, and that maybe some of you will feel inspired to have a healthier relationship to that. But that's not the goal of the conference, okay? And so there are absolute truths and relative truths. So we'll go through, there are five core elements to integral theory, and I'm going to present the three more important ones, in my opinion, and then I'll just give a brief outline of the two last ones. So, the first element are the levels. As we said, everything is made of holons. Holons are these Russian dolls. When you think about the matter, the physical world, the physiosphere, as some people call it, everything is composed of atoms. And this is what constitutes reality. But we see that atoms, when they gather together, they form molecules, which can form cells, for example, and when they gather together, they form the brain. These are exactly like the Russian dolls I was mentioning earlier. But this goes all the way up, but it goes all the way down. Atoms, in the modern world, we thought that atoms were the smallest existing thing, but actually, we discovered that they contain particles and subatomic particles and so on. So, holons go all the way up and all the way down. But we see that, interestingly, when we look at psychology, it works exactly the same way. There's a common pattern. So, John Gebser was an anthropologist, and he was one of the anthropologists who put out this evolution process in terms of our worldviews. So let's get back to when we were babies. We probably don't remember it, but studies show consistently that babies don't differentiate from the world, from the outside world. They have not formed their persona yet, their ego, and so when a baby sees an adult crying, the baby will start crying because the baby just thinks that they're the same person. And it sounds really crazy to us today because it's like, oh, that's totally impossible. But actually, studies show that the babies do not differentiate from the outside world. And this is what Gebser calls the archaic stage. Actually, it's funny to see that the development of babies and children actually was reflected in the development of humanity. So when you have a baby, or think about little cousin, little brother or sister, 2 years old or 1 year old, they will act on impulse. I want to eat, I just cry, I don't care about anything, I just cry to get what I want. And it's pretty much the same psychological process as the cavemen. The cavemen, when they wanted to hunt, they were hungry, they just went out and hunted. If they wanted sex, they just went for sex. They didn't think about, is it a good thing or a bad thing? They just acted on impulse, archaic stage. But then eventually they evolve and they grow up in a more magic stage. For kids, it's going to be when they believe that by simple thought, they can change the world. For example, I don't like my spinach in my plate, so I'm going to think it's going to become candy, and my thought is going to bring me candy in the plate. For us, it seems totally crazy, but kids at a certain age really believe this works. And this is also reflected in societies who are at a magic level of consciousness. So these are, for example, shamans that believe that because they make a ritual and a rain dance, it's going to rain, and their behavior will affect the outside world. But then they grow up to another stage, which is the mythic stage. So mythic is when the child starts to believe in, for example, superheroes, and he really believes that superheroes exist. And sometimes it can even follow them through adulthood for the superheroes fans. But most of all, they think that Santa Claus is real or that the Easter Bunny is real. And what I'm going to say might be shocking to you, but from an anthropological standpoint, Gebser and other researchers show that people who have fundamentalist beliefs are in the exact process of thought. For example, a fundamentalist who reads, I'm going to use the example of the Quran, for example, a terrorist of Daesh, it's not that he cannot understand and use rationality, it's just that he's at a mythical psychological age where he just believes that this is true and interprets the text at a very literal point of view. Yeah.
Regarding the example you just gave us, Daesh is using a lot of rational also. I mean, this terrorist is perhaps believing things about Quran, I don't know what, but he's using Kalashnikov and weapons of all kinds of weapons, clothing and stuff like this. So he's kind of rational also.
Absolutely, and we'll see that. That's a great thing that you bring this up. Wilber says that one of the problems with this fundamentalist terrorism is that some of the people, not all terrorists, but let's say the masses that constitute the terrorist groups, or we could use the Taliban as a better example maybe, are at a magic or mythic level of consciousness, but they're using modern and rational technology. So the technology is ahead of their state of consciousness. And this might seem far out, but when we look at the data on how humans evolve, it makes a lot of sense. So you're not going to use rational arguments against someone who has fundamental beliefs, because it's just not efficient. The person is not there in terms of the development. And here, we need to be really cautious, because this is maybe not very popular to say that, because we want people to be... It doesn't mean that these people are not as good and so on, it's just that we are all at different levels of consciousness. And that's one of the main points of integral theory. So, then you go to the rational. So when you're a human, you get into your teenage years, and then you start to question all these myths. Yeah, but of course I know that Easter Bunny doesn't exist, or maybe even what my parents told me is not true, and so on, and you start to get all this reasoning. And that's what humans do. Humans did that, question all the religious beliefs, and you start to question them with rational thinking. And Wilber says that we need to go beyond rationality and integrate all the previous stages into a bigger stage of awareness and of knowing. So how can you use rationality, but still not dismiss the myths? One example I think of is, let's imagine that I was a dad. I would not just say, no kid, Santa Claus does not exist, it's not rational. No, I'm going to pretend he's existing, so my 5-year-old son can be happy at Christmas. But I know as an adult that it's not rational. But it doesn't mean that the myth goes to the rubbish bin. It just means that you interpret it from your state of consciousness and from your level. And this is very important about levels. Every human being interprets reality from his own level. So if we look at the same thing, we're going to interpret from the same level. So if I, have you seen all these videos like on the internet when someone goes into an African tribe, for example, and they use an iPhone or something like that. If the tribe is at a magic level of consciousness, they'll think that it's a magical object. But if the person using the iPhone is just at the rational, he'll know that, no, it's just been built by Apple, and this is how it works, and it's got components, and so on. That's an example of how we interpret reality from our own level of consciousness.
I'm thinking that the environment has some influence on our thought, on the way we consider this. So let's So it's proof that if you hear a lot, if you are exposed to a lot of this is bad, there is a terrorist everywhere, every day, then you just think about terrorism.
So, there are two ways to integrate the environment. The first, since we're talking about levels, the environment and the environment at a, let's take the broad definition of environment, okay? Not just the environment as nature, but environment with people who you are with and so on. This can help you, this can either slow you down in your development or it can accelerate your development. So the pace of your development is influenced by the environment, related to levels of development of consciousness. The environment will be taken into account when we talk about the third element of integral theory, when we talk about quadrants. So then you can see maybe what relationship humans can have with their environment. And we'll talk about that during the third point. And if it didn't answer the question, please bring your question back again, okay? Yes.
Can the lower levels of consciousness comprehend the higher ones?
So they can comprehend it, but from their own perspective. That's the thing. So, for example, for us, let's imagine that we're overall at a rational level of consciousness. That's just an assumption. When I read description of, I'm very interested in knowing what it looks like to be at very high levels of consciousness. So I read some descriptions in some of Wilber's books. And it's really interesting to see the possibilities. But we understand them only with our own limitations, since I'm always interpreting reality from my own level of development. So, of course, it's like, I remember when I was a kid and people told me, yeah, you'll see when you'll be 18 and you can go into a club. Of course, I can, you know, have this fantasy of what it's like to go in a club and so on, but I can only imagine from my 10-year-old self. Can a 10-year-old self really know what it's like to be in a disco? I don't know. But when you're 18 and you go in the club, you experiment the club, and that's how you do it. And I give this trivial example about the club, which is fun, but Wilber talks about it for spiritual experiences. So, he says that some people reject totally spirituality, like some scientists or some people who just believe in factual things, but they have not tried to go. So they'll say that the disco is not fun or it doesn't exist, but they haven't been there. So that's one of the theses of Wilber. And we see that for each stage of development, Wilber did this amazing work to correlate them with epochs. And epochs were concepts developed by other researchers, such as Jürgen Habermas, for example. And Habermas says that humanity evolved from groups and families, to tribes, to villages, to empires, to nation states, and maybe in the future we might see a planetary organization. But that's only correlated to the levels of development of humans. Because of course someone at a mythic level of consciousness cannot even imagine, let's say, a nation state, because he has an ethnocentric morality. So it means that a Taliban is only going to relate to other Talibans, and he does not necessarily want to form a nation with other people from Afghanistan. But other people from Afghanistan, such as the current government, for example, they're from a modern state of consciousness. So they will say, no, it's okay to build a nation and we should be one Afghan nation. And Wilber, in his works, the correlations between all these various works that have been done by separate researchers. So I'll talk about his method later, but basically he tried to find how can we connect all this together. And this we'll see in a minute. Yes.
Maybe two questions. The first one would be, for instance, new generation people believing in a global world, for them, the world is global. So they are ethnocentric, the whole world. Can we say that?
Yes.
Before the new planet.
Let me think. That's a question I ask myself. I do not know exactly. If you said, it, I think it's a matter of definitions. If ethnocentric is people from the same group, and you just use the root of ethnos and I don't know what the root for centric is, but whatever. Maybe you can tell us.
Can we say of the normal again? Of the how it's in English?
Oh yeah, the belly button.
Yeah. But anyway, my point is, if you consider that you have a unique world, which is the only one, the whole world could be, the global world could be, you know, could provoke kind of an analogical ethnocentrism.
Absolutely, but in this case, if we use the, let's say, the Wilberian terminology, we're going to say world-centric, because it's not about ethno, it's not about the group, it's about the whole world.
Yeah, but yeah. Without diversity, it's only one world.
Hmm. Yeah, I think it's totally, normally,
it's
someone at an integral stage of development or of consciousness would definitely have this definition of one world and sensation, and it would not be a construct. Like maybe for some of us, it's something you have to imagine, but for someone at an integral stage of consciousness, it's just natural and normal. And I give this example: if you're the Dalai Lama, it's not a question. It's not something you have to ask yourself. Dalai Lama is definitely at least at a higher level of consciousness, and he sincerely believes that whether he's hugging someone from India, someone from Africa, a man or a woman, they're definitely all the same as his Tibetan people. Now that we have seen the first element of levels, some people might think, yeah, but it's maybe too easy to reduce a human to a level of consciousness. And that's true. And part of integral theory wants to explain humans deeper. And this is why we're going to move on to lines. So, what are lines? Actually, these are the various forms, for example, of intelligence. If we look at psychology, every human being has various types of intelligences. So, in the modern paradigm, in the pre-modern, it was brute force that counted. So, for example, the stronger the person, the better. And that was a very masculine way of seeing things. But now, in the modern world, people said, no, it's about being smart. It's not necessarily about being the strongest physically. And now, in postmodern, or we would say integral, we are going to say, no, humans have various types of intelligences, and we should be able to look at the big picture. So what are the different types of intelligences? Here is what we call a psychograph, which would be used in integral psychology to make a map of your levels or lines of development. So if I took a psychograph, I could have, for example, 6 criteria. And there are protocols that are established to, like IQ tests, but for various intelligences. So of course you would have the cognitive line, for example, which would be, for example, IQ, but you would also have the interpersonal line, the psychosexual line, the emotional line, the moral line, and actually some researchers have established up to 24 lines. So you would have the somatic line, how you use your body. Michael Jordan would have a wonderful somatic line. You could have an aesthetic line if you're able to differentiate what you think is beautiful from what you think is ugly, or some people who just don't really care about that and who don't have a developed line. And each individual is at a particular stage of development and has various lines. So, just in order to see 2 brief examples, if we think about a criminal genius, for example, he would have a very high cognitive line because it's like psychopaths. Studies show that psychopaths have a very high cognitive line, and they're very smart. But he would have low moral, emotional, interpersonal, and spiritual lines. And you have questions which relate to each line. So, for example, for the cognitive line, you can ask yourself, what am I aware of? What is my level of awareness of things? But there's also an ego line. Who am I? How you define yourself? Values. What is significant to me? There's a moral line. What should I do? And depending on how you answer the question, you will be at various levels of development. And then spiritual would be, what is of my ultimate concern? And researchers in development have made tests in order to see how much you score and what's the level of your line. Another example is this artist, Alex Gray. And we'll talk about Alex Gray later, but for example, if it was a cosmocentric artist, he would have very high cognitive line, but he could also have a high moral line, maybe not as much as a big emotional line, and so on. So it's just to show you that we should see it from an integral perspective. We should see the human being as a whole, and not just as a smart, or not just EQ and IQ, for example. So that's the basic idea behind lines.
Excuse me, the five ones here are the old lines?
Here are the five that are used for the basic psychographs in psychology, but actually, depending on what you want to test, you can add up to 20 more. And research is still not very advanced in the lines, because it's maybe 10 or 15, it's a concept that is 10 or 15 years old. So it's not a big surprise that it hasn't been into the mainstream of academia yet. And then, before I explain what quadrants are, I'd like to explain one way that Wilber came up with this concept of quadrants. So Ken Wilber has this obsession about understanding everything, okay? And he had written already, I don't know, maybe a dozen or 15 books or something like that. And it was this one book that he really wanted to write. And he locked himself up in his home for 3 years, and he saw maybe 3 or 4 people who came to visit him, but basically he was like a hermit, and he was receiving all these books and just reading and writing for 3 straight years. And he was trying to understand how things could come up together, because he had worked already on consciousness and so on. He published his first book at 24 years old, and he was considered the pioneer into consciousness studies and revered by academia after dropping out from a degree in biochemistry or neurology or something like that. And in this 3 years writing his masterpiece, there was one point of time where he just looked at all the theories, so all the lines that I presented from Piaget, for example, or Gebzer or Habermas and plenty of others. Every time he took the model of development, he drew this arrow and he put it on the floor. And he had these 200 notepads on the floor. And he was trying to figure it out, but it took him 3 months walking in his dining room and understand what's the pattern that connects. And then someday it started to connect and he went like, oh, this is it, now I'm getting the big picture. So he found that in reality, there are basically 4 dimensions.
Excuse me, how old was he when he was?
When he did that, that was in 95, so he was in his 50s. Yeah. Yeah, now he's in his late 60s. And this is how he came up with the quadrants. So basically, reality is composed of 4 aspects. And I'm actually going to use just the board to make it clear. So looking at all these models, he said that some of the models talk about the same thing and some of the models don't talk about the same thing. So how do I discriminate? How do I make a difference between what is the same and what is not the same?
Sorry,
yes.
May I ask another question?
Sure.
Does he tell the story you just mentioned?
Sorry?
In 3 years, does he tell the story he writes down?
Yes.
The way he discusses?
Yes. That's
in the very book or?
It's not in the very book, but it's in one of his interviews. So it's really interesting to see him speak as a person. By the way, I'll get to
that. And the point is, once he does he want to integrate this story in the theory?
I think he wants to produce a theory that is quite detached from his own story, so he doesn't really mix up his personal writings, and actually what he's writing is more like a philosophy, a manual, something like that. If you want to understand reality, just read this and you'll get it. He doesn't say it like that, but that's a shortcut. And if you want to read more about his story, he published 1 year of journaling, so it's his journal Everyday Thoughts during the year 1997, which is captivating to see how he lives and so on. And otherwise there are some interviews or things like that, but he doesn't always explain how he came up with the ideas in his books. So, he found out that actually there's one dimension, which is the individual. And the other, on the other side, you have the collective. Individual and collective. And so some of these charts talk about individual things, and some other charts explain the collective. And here he says there are also the interiors. And we'll see what that means. And here the exterior. And with these quadrants, it's his way of integrating everything. So remember when we talked about the differentiation of arts, morals, and science earlier. So you would have the arts here, because it's an individual interior perspective. It's how I perceive the painting, for example. That's my subjectivity. It's my interpretation of the painting. Morals would be interior and collective. It's what everybody from one society thinks about morality or culture and so on. So arts, morals. And then, that's all interiors, but we could look at the exterior. What is visible from the outside? And that is science. And that's his way, very simple when it's presented like that, to integrate the three and to say that if you want to have a good view on reality, you need to answer it from these four quadrants. He calls it either the four quadrants, but also the big three, because actually he says that it's hard to distinguish sometimes individual science from collective science. So you just look at things from the outside or from the inside. And if you think about the ancient philosophy questions, for example, from Plato, that's the good, the true, and the beautiful. Or if you think about Immanuel Kant's work, it's going to be critique of pure reason, metaphysics of morality, and...
critique of judgment?
Exactly, thank you. Critique of judgment. And if you look at the great works of great philosophers, they fit into these three quadrants. So if we look at what that means with other examples and all the notepads that he had on his floor, you can look that you don't need to focus on the details, as we said, but the main idea is that on the upper left quadrant, which is intentional, interior, individual, you have the evolution of how a person will perceive things. So at a low level, it's going to be very just on sensation, but then that evolves into perception, then emotion, symbols, concepts, etc., etc. So a person will perceive a symbol or an image before the person can perceive a meaning and rationality behind. And all this is holons, as we mentioned before. If we look at it from the outside, that's when you ask someone to describe something. But if we look at it from the outside, you get how science studies all this. And that's really captivating to see a person express himself, upper left. But you see science trying to explain all this. So that's when you study atoms and molecules and so on, and when they evolve, and they evolve into a reptilian brainstem, which is included, transcended and included in the limbic system, the neocortex, complex neocortex, and so on. So you see the biological evolution correlated with the interior evolution and the evolution of mind of someone. And here it's correlated with the exterior as well. And if we look at it, for example, what we talked about, magic, mythic, rational, etc., we looked at magic, number 10, is going to be with concepts. So a person at a magical level will be able to use concepts, but not yet rules or a formal thought, because it has not yet developed the complex neocortex, which is at fulcrum 10. So all this is quite technical, but actually the correlations seem to work and to hold up with all the documentation amassed by researchers. So I'm going to give you a concrete example derived from one book written on integral ecology. So Esbjørn Hargens wrote a book which took a lot of time to be written as well about integral ecology. How can we design ecology for the future from an integral perspective? And basically, if you want an integral ecology, you're going to take into account as much the individual experiences, such as psychological levels, as we said, states, pathologies, and so on, as much as the exterior, health of the organism, physical effects, and so on. And you're going to use also the two other quadrants, which are the collective systems, ecosystemic impact, political dynamics, and so on, and the interiors, group values, religious systems, worldviews, and so on. And once you get the four quadrants, you get a better whole picture of a situation to solve an ecological crisis, for example, instead of just trying from one perspective. So basically, if you had only one thing to remember about the quadrants, is that they help us understand a reality from a broader perspective. Instead of having just the scientist giving you the exteriors, you have the scientist giving you the exteriors, but maybe he'll also accept that the psychologist has something to say about the situation. So, we're not going to go into depth into the states, but that's the fourth element of integral theory. States are basically, when you're a human, these are the various states of mind that we go through every day. So the three basic states are waking, sleep, and dream state. And every human being goes through these different states. That's the upper left quadrant. So that's the interior individual. But there are other states, for example, lower right, which is going to be exterior collective, could be weather states, is it sunny, is it cloudy, and so on, or economic state, is it, for example, a recession, or is it economic growth, and so on. So that's just the basic idea of states. And as you notice, these states can be used in combination with quadrants to separate the states. So you see that integral theory, as a complexity theory, you use one element and you're going to use it with the others, and you get a synergy between the various five elements of integral theory. So I could just present a huge list of states, but you can classify them by quadrants. And maybe it feels a bit dizzy, that's totally normal, but once you get used to hearing these concepts, you get more familiar on how you can use them. The last element are types. We saw that humans evolve through different stages or different levels, and one level is more inclusive than the previous one. More inclusive and holds more, it's more whole. But for types, that's a different thing. There are just various aspects or various styles of one same reality. So we have personality types in psychology with, for example, Myers-Briggs. If you take a Myers-Briggs test, you will see what your type is. We can have an Enneagram type, or simply gender, male or female. And a male can be at a certain level of development or at another, and a female can be at the same level of development. So these are just two different paths, two different ways. And you get blood types. Okay, so one blood type does not evolve into another blood type. It's just a different thing. We're not talking about the same blood type. and body type. For example, body type will be if you're ectomorphic, which means that you're rather thin and you have a metabolism that burns a lot of calories. So if you eat a lot, you're not going to put on some weight easily. You have endomorphic, and so you have three different body types. And knowing the types means that you have you can have a strategy that is better adapted to your type. So if you know your personality, you know who you can deal with easily or who you can have difficulties to deal with. Or for body types, you have special training for endomorphic people. What should you eat when you're endomorphic, or what should you eat when you're ectomorphic? And so on and so forth. And just as an example, they mentioned religious systems. That's just the derivative of the perennial philosophy. So it doesn't really matter if you're Buddhist, Hindu, or so on. It's just a different type. What you should see is at which level of consciousness you are. And an example, I assume, is that when you look at, for example, the Dalai Lama, he might have more in common with Pope Francis than with the fundamentalist in Myanmar who is just being violent against Muslims. Because the Dalai Lama is at a higher level of consciousness, and Pope Francis is just a different type, but they might be at the same level of consciousness together. So that's just a new interpretation of how we see reality. Yes? Does someone have a question? No? Yeah, that's pretty interesting, and especially for Laurent. It's an example to show you that you can be at various stages of development and how that mixes up with types. So when you're at the pre-conventional stage of development, you're going to think about yourself and what are your needs. Archaic, it's like the baby, you don't think about the family or anything, you just think, what do I want? And you're going to act upon it. And this can be declined in the feminine type, which is selfish care, it's me, because the feminine will emphasize more on the care and relationship and responsibility for moral development, that's the moral line. Whereas in the pre-conventional stage, a masculine, which emphasizes more on autonomy, rights, justice, is going to say selfish rights. So care for women and rights for men, or masculine. Then you move into a conventional stage. So when the kids grow up, they learn to socialize and that family is important and I cannot do what I want as a kid. And there are rules to be obeyed or respected. So I should not use the term women because gender and sex are different. But feminine will say, what is our care, our clan? And that's the conventional stage of development. And the masculine will say, what are our rights as a group? So we grow to an ethnocentric morality. And finally, when we grow to a post-conventional or world-centric morality, the feminine will be about universal care about everybody, versus the masculine will be about universal rights for everybody. And you can see that maybe the Universal Declaration of Human Rights would maybe not have the same name if it had been written by women, because it would be maybe about care and not about rights. So we see still a sort of domination of masculine even in the Declaration of Human Rights. And this shows you how types are just two different expressions of one same level of development.
Yes? But isn't that more societal though? Like, isn't it a little sexist to say women go with care and men go with rights? That's more societal.
So I don't know if it's sexist, but all the work of one researcher called Kohlberg researched that for men, and based on Kohlberg's work, Carol Gilligan did the research on women, and she saw that by doing all the research and all the questioning, women emphasized more on care and men emphasized more on rights. So the way the research was conducted was not about to be sexist, but it was just to observe what was important to the women and what was important to the men.
That's what I'm saying. This is more societal conditioning rather than something that comes from within.
So it might be because of societal conditioning, and I think that could be interesting to explore into Carol Gilligan's work. So that would be an analysis of the reasons, but here are just facts that are presented that nowadays in the research that have been conducted, with the biases that might be social conditioning, I don't know, I haven't been into that depth, but these are the facts that were presented in the research, yeah.
Yeah, what it reminds me actually more of masculine and feminine is kind of yin and yang, right? You see yin being feminine, like yin and yang. I mean, this is really how I see it. And that's so, and I would go on with the idea that when we talk about, even when we talk about gender, the main idea about gender is that as a man you can identify more with the feminine, and as a girl you can identify more with the masculine. And since we began to mix roles in the 60s, as you said, postmodern and stuff like this, we now have men being more into music and dance and I don't know what, you know,
salsa.
Long hair and being very salsa, for example, thank you for and having long hair and being very feminine on many aspects. And now you have girls being in position of power and authority and displaying power plays, I don't know, with what, you know. I mean, that's the way I see it, more about yin-yang more than feminine and masculine.
Yeah, and that could be just another reinterpretation, and it's funny because we're talking about this with Laurent about the yin-yang as well. Mm-hmm. And this could be just a different expression of the same reality that could be explained. And for those of you who are really interested in to this gender question, I invite you to read just the introduction of Ken Wilber, of his brief history of everything. You read this and he starts it out with the gender issue.
Yes.
I know it's always a danger to make a shortcut. Male and female. But what comes to my mind is the average of feminine and masculine students in different types of studies. But as far as I know, in medicine, the students are more and more feminine. On another side, in engineering school, the level of feminine doesn't change. Doesn't
work. I'm an engineer, it's still the same percentage.
So.
Yeah.
This shows something of the society.
Yes, and I think we could have a huge debate on the reasons and the factors behind that, and I would not know how to answer. I have not dug into this question, but we do see that, yeah, women are definitely more represented in some areas than in some others, but it still pertains, in my opinion, it pertains to what level of consciousness the society or the individuals are. And the more you grow your level of consciousness, the more you're able to differentiate the sex, the biological sex, from the gender and the identity.
Yes, I think to go on with the idea of what you said and environment also, I think it all relates also to the idea that environments will tend to form your being more masculine or feminine. I mean, I have done an engineering school. I think that, yes, engineering school tends to be more...
You are the normal case and it is the exceptional.
Yes. No, I think they tend to make you more masculine because this is the values down there. And I would say, engineering school, for example, makes you more rational. To answer about the idea of about environments also made scientific or bankers, banking system tends to make you think about figures and I don't know what, you know, and more makes you more rational, and environments tends to put you in certain stage and certain kind of feminine or masculine energy. So, but I don't know what tool you plan to show us about the environment's final influence. But
So basically the environment influence would be in the right quadrants, and especially maybe the lower right as plural, okay? That could be observable from the outside. If you want to know if something is from the left quadrant, of the two left quadrants, you say, can I see it from the outside? If it's no, it means it's here. If I want to know what someone thinks, I cannot see it from the outside, I cannot measure it with a machine. So I need to ask this person, what do you think, what are your perceptions, what's your worldview? But these realities manifest in the outside and they translate to the other quadrants. This is how they're correlated. So if I have a particular worldview, I'm going to dress in a particular way, and that will manifest in the outside. But it doesn't tell me the whole story. It's not enough to know what I'm thinking. And this is how the quadrants are linked, but how they're still distinguished. You distinguish both, but you need both at the same time. Okay. And about that, about the link with the environment, I would just use some of Edgar Morin's concepts about the, I don't know how you translate in English, the boucle récursive, that I influence my environment and the environment influences me, and all these quadrants influence each other. So morals, if you have a particular moral or cultural worldview, that will be manifested and influence the outside. Let's say I'm a Christian, I think that God is great and that churches are important. I'm going to build churches that you can see from the outside. So archaeology will be great to study the churches, but it will not be enough to study what are the beliefs of a Christian person. If you want the big picture, let's say on Christianity, you're going to use all the quadrants and the arts, for example, of Christianity and what Christian individual beliefs are and each individual thinks to get the big picture. So this is how the link between environment and person. Okay. So now we have seen types, and that was the last element, and now we have the five ingredients to make a beautiful integral theory. So every time we want to apply integral theory, we can use these five elements to analyze reality. And that's what we'll do right now for our last part, with three examples of real-world applications of this theory.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Boucle récursive, recursive loop.
Okay, so is everybody still here? Did we lose people along the way, or is it okay for everyone? Yeah.
One question which is coming back, why?
Sorry?
One of the questions which is emerging is why all these? Ah. And you said you would come back to this because you said we are practitioners, so we could ask you why? Why all these and what for?
Yes, what for? I would prefer what for, because why we could get back into philosophy, and what for will be into the hard stuff. So, one consulting cabinet, consulting firm, Eichheit Development Associates, did some consulting for UNICEF, and they studied the UNICEF strategy and vision using integral theory. And I'm just going to show you how they use the quadrants to define UNICEF's issue. So basically, they studied the various strategies of UNICEF, and they found out that in the 50s, it was the era of disease campaigns. 60s, decade of development. 70s, era of alternatives. 80s, era of child survival. 90s, decade of children's rights. Do you see a common pattern here? Or something that links all these eras together? What's the common point between these various eras? Well, now you see why it took Wilber 3 months to figure it out. Okay. The common point is that they're all right quadrants. They focus only on the exteriors. So disease campaigns, development, that's all, you can see that in the outside. Alternatives, child survival, children's rights. Okay. But in the 2000s, they, Eichheit Development Associates, suggested that how about we take a more integral approach and look at the two quadrants that had been forgotten. And so basically, they started to base their studies also on worldviews, and if UNICEF, who has maybe a modern or maybe postmodern approach, is dealing with issues like that, they should know that they're dealing with countries who might be still at the mythic or at the mythic worldview. So if they were dealing maybe with some country, I don't know, in Africa and some populations, you cannot deal with child disease the same way when you're talking with people who use rationality, such as in Western countries, or people who are still at the magic or mythic level. And this is, these are all the problems that that we meet when we look at development and development issues, because obviously the levels are not matching. We're talking from a modern or postmodern perspective, thinking this is normal and everyone can think like that, but we're not talking about, we are not thinking in the way that the receivers of the service or the funds will act. That was an example that was shared to me by someone who worked in Democratic Republic of Congo, and she was telling me that when they made this program for a refugee camp, they brought, I don't even remember, it was some accessory to make food. Oh yeah, it was a stove. And they made stove because they saw that the people from the refugee camp were cutting all the trees. And the stove seemed like a practical solution. But the stove was so nice and fancy that people don't even use it, and they preferred the smell of the food with the chopped trees. So that's a typical example of a modern or postmodern approach to a problem that cannot fit if you don't take into account the level of consciousness of the people you're dealing with. It doesn't mean that you have to give them a pre-modern solution. It just means that you need to take it into account in an integral perspective. So if you're, I'm into the negotiation field, if you're negotiating from a rational point of view and you're talking with a mythic literal person, if I'm negotiating with a Taliban, a war chief, I should be talking and communicating in a way that he can relate to. So using maybe more masculine and patriarchal and talking about power, because this is what he believes in and the way he deals with. There was a great work done by Adam Leonard on integral communication. How can you communicate in an integral way? I'll write it down. So it's Leonard, like Leonard da Vinci. Yeah. And then integral communication. And you can download the paper online, or I can send it to you by email if you want. So that's one example. Second example. What do you see?
Good question.
We'll get answers soon. Who would like to dive in?
For me, it's like, you know, when they drink, you know, the shamanic drink?
Yes.
And they get this kind of vision from what I understood, so it's more integral.
Okay, so are you referring to ayahuasca?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so ayahuasca is a plant that is used by shamanic tribes in the Amazon to get sort of visions. And it's really interesting to see what research says about ayahuasca. Let's not get into details here.
Can we try it?
Can we try it?
If you have some.
We'll see. I'll bring some on the next conference and we'll all get on ayahuasca. Yes, Mathieu?
You already showed me this one, but I will answer the same as I already told you about. To me, this is hippie Hindu New Age art.
So here we see that there's an objective truth being interpreted by a subjective mind. Okay, so for me, it's hippie art, that is okay. What I see is two people having sex in missionary position, and flames radiating out, and they're connected together, and they're connected to the cosmos. And we see an integral perspective to me, because you see as much the bones, all the rational, but also the transrational with all the energies and everything flowing. And I hesitated to present that, because I was thinking, yeah, but you're showing something deliberately on sex, something that can be taboo. But the goal for me was to show you the subjectivity and how your culture and everything can influence the way you perceive that.
The chairman completely doesn't assume this responsibility.
Of course, and I said it was, I made a personal claimer, so there's no worries about that. And the goal of this was to show you that maybe some people felt some emotions, maybe shock or disgust or amazement or whatever, and this is your lower left quadrant manifesting right as you see the picture. And the upper left is your subjectivity, and lower left is the morals, or maybe what we can do in society or not. Can someone present a painting of two people having sex in a research seminar? Is that a correct thing to do? That's your morality. And it all depends. Someone at a conventional stage of development might say no, and someone at a post-conventional might say no, it's okay, he wanted to prove a point or whatever. A fundamentalist would say, no, there's no way that can happen. So integral art, can be perceived through the four quadrants, as we just said. So you use the experience, but also the behavior of your of the people who are watching and witnessing the art, but behavior of the artist and the process of creation. And the process of creation is taken from the postmodern. It's not only about the result, it's also about how you get there. So maybe the process of thought, about how the artist thought about this art. And then the world and the social aspects of it, as much as the cultural aspects. In the painting, we couldn't see the details, but there were a lot of symbols and so on, which are linked to cultures and religions and myths and beliefs. And all of it is integrated into one painting by this artist called Alex Gray. So Alex Gray gave this amazing TED Talk, which I highly recommend to you, which you can find on YouTube, on cosmic creativity, how art evolves consciousness. And this TED Talk I found very inspiring, and I felt a lot of emotion looking at it. But what I wanted to use for this presentation is that Alex Gray told about his story as an artist, and it's funny how he talks about his levels of development. So first he showed a picture, a drawing that he made when he was 5 years old. So it was very magic, and he uses these terms. He uses integral to make his art. Very magic, and he draws the skeleton of death just in a very simple way. Then he moves on to mythic, with death in a very mythic representation. Then to rational, where he draws the skeleton in a very precise and scientific way, just like in the Renaissance. And then, I forgot the integral, where he integrates the modern view and the rational view, but he also uses symbols from many religions, because he believes in the perennial philosophy. And finally, transcendental, where it's you don't even see anymore what are the distinctive parts, but the art is transcended in the picture. So this was just to show you basically the levels of development that an artist can go through, or a person can go through, to interpret art. And Wilber, in his book Integral Psychology, put this great chart in all his correlations. It's really fascinating. At the end of Integral Psychology, you get maybe 15 or 30 charts, which are all correlated to the different levels of development. And one of them is the development of your appreciation for art. So if you just like things that is realistic, for example, you might be at a conventional, modern line of development in terms of aesthetics, if you like art. I remember a couple of years ago, I just loved movies that were realistic. I did not like movies that went in other directions or that did not tell a real story. Now I know that my level of aesthetic line moved on to post-conventional, because I like things that are more open, or even sometimes psychedelic, or stories you don't know what's going to happen, but I still like them. And that's explained in Wilber's model of development. So we won't go into detail, and we could have a whole talk on art. Last example is simply integral psychology, and we've covered pretty much integral psychology as examples throughout the presentation. But it's just to show you that integral psychology should include levels, lines, with all the lines and all the works done by the various researchers, types, so the type will influence the psychology of a person and so on, all the states, whereas in Western psychology it has not been we're always talking about the waking state. Maybe Freud started to do some dream interpretation, but if we look in the East, they've studied what happens in the dreams and in shamanic cultures as well, and so it's about integrating all the pre-modern things and looking at it from a rational perspective and reframing what we learn from the pre-modern, the modern, and the post-modern, and get a better understanding of our different states. When we dream, in Western culture, when you're sleeping, you're kind of wasting time. But actually, science and neuroscience is discovering all the things and the processes involved in dreams. And of course, integrating quadrants as well. And when you integrate the five, you have an overall integral psychology. Yes?
understand the question, because unless I heard badly, when we were talking about the levels, you talk about shamanic in the magic level, not in the integral transcendental level. So, and I was wondering if, like, even the archaic or magic, you know, levels were not more, making a loop with the transcendental or integral.
That's a good question. Okay, when we describe the stage, the worldviews, and we talk about magic, it doesn't mean necessarily shamanic.
Yeah.
A shaman can be at the magic level, or at the mythic level, maybe, or he can be very rational. And if you look at contemporary shamans, for example, in Peru and so on, a lot of them have education and even PhDs, and they think in a very rational way. But since when you're at integral, you will integrate some aspects of the magic. So you're not just going to say it's magic, it doesn't exist. You're going to investigate what is real, what is not real, what works, what doesn't work. If you're just at the modern, you might say, no, this is old, I don't want to hear about it. So that's the difference. So now we need to look at a precise shaman, and we could look at his psychograph and try to evaluate where he is. But you bring up a point that we haven't gotten to. It's something that Wilber calls the pre-trance fallacy. You need to make a difference between what is pre-conventional and what is post-conventional or trans-conventional. So he gives the example of Lawrence Kohlberg making his experiments to determine if a child was at a pre-conventional level of morality, conventional or post-conventional. And they told the children a story. Okay, Mr. Heinz has his wife, and his wife is going to die. So there's someone in the village, and he produced the medicine, and you need this medicine, but it costs $2,000. You have only $1,000. So you go and see the person, you say, please, can you give me your medicine for $1,000? And he says, no, I want to make money out of my patent. Yeah, but my wife is going to die. Doesn't matter, I want my $2,000. So Mr. Heinz goes and decides to steal the medicine from this guy's place when the guy is sleeping. And now the Kohlberg asks the children, what do you think? What do you think about the situation? And usually children at a low age, I think it's before 7, but I'm not sure about the data, they will say, no, it's, he did well because he wanted to do it. He wanted to do it. At a conventional stage, the children, so later, maybe from 7 to 10, they said, no, it's not good because stealing is bad. Conventional. And then post-conventional, they say, maybe when they were 11 until 17, they said, no, it's perfectly fine because his wife is more important than the money of the other guy. So they can go beyond the rules. But if you look at the action of Mr. Heinz, he did the exact same thing. Whether he was at a post-conventional level, thinking beyond the rules, or pre-conventional, even ignoring the rules and doing what he wanted. So you can do the same thing, but for two totally different reasons. And that's really important. So it's like Martin Luther King, he was at a post-conventional because he didn't mind breaking society's rules if he thought that the rules were not just and not fair. And so that's the difference. And he says that with spirituality, it's the same. You should make the difference between what is, you know, magic and shamanic or just hippie stuff that has no ground at all. Or if you made your own experiments and your own experience and you're looking at things that go beyond rational because maybe technology is not able to explain it yet. But maybe in 50 years we'll have machines able to measure. It's like meditation. Nowadays, EEG machines can measure the waves of the brain, and this was not possible 20 years ago. But 20 years ago, scientists would say, no, it doesn't exist, meditation is not possible. So Wilber is saying you need to find what is pre-conventional, what is post-conventional.
Mm-hmm. And okay. That moves as well. Because if that moves with technology, what is pre-conventional and post-conventional?
Absolutely. We could think that there will be, of course, stages beyond integral, or after a while we'll say that all this is just conventional and we need to go to post-conventional. So just to finish, a lot of topics have been explored from an integral perspective. So there's a publication, the Journal of Integral Theory and Practice, JITP, And you can read fascinating articles about integral education, integral management and business, medicine, politics, paper on communication. Even Wilber published a book on integral spirituality that I haven't read yet. And one of my next fields of inquiry is going to be integral negotiation and conflict resolution. Because now I know that negotiation is used in the modern paradigm with what we know and so on, and differentiating and other things. Some of it is postmodern, but I believe that we can include and use Wilber's framework to update the field of negotiation. And maybe you in your fields might find some interest to use some of the interesting aspects that you liked about integral theory. Yeah, Kevin.
Yeah. So just to come back on what you just have said, how on a daily basis we can use that kind of theory to like enhance our life and maybe have a better job, more money, better social interaction, that kind of stuff.
Interesting. I can tell you some of the things I do. There's a great book called Integral Life Practice, and so it suggests how practices can enhance your life. I'll give you one example. A simple example of how integral can help you in your life. I use it for communication. I try to find, if I'm dealing with someone, how to communicate better. So I try to see what stage I am and what stage this person is at, to see what matters to this person. So that takes a bit of practice, of course, but in integral communication, they have a great study about that, a case study about that. Another thing is a cross-training. Instead of being specialized in one field, you can use many fields, and since all fields connect together, Wilber gives this example of a study that was conducted. Take two groups of people, one group that does a certain number of hours, let's say during 3 months they're going to do 10 hours of meditation, spread out through the 3 months, and during the same period of time they take another group that does 5 hours of meditation and 5 hours of training, like of fit training, okay, and weightlifting. And at the end of the 3 months, they hand out the two groups to evaluators to evaluate the level of accomplishments in meditation. And of course, the people who evaluate them don't know who was part of which group. And at the end of the 3 months, the people who did half meditation and half weightlifting get better scores at meditation than those who did just meditation. So that's also an invitation not to ultra-specialize in one thing, but just to have a more diverse and integral view and practice. But integral practice is another huge field that you could see. But basically, it's about not neglecting. First thing you could do, basic thing, I would say, take a piece of paper, draw the four quadrants and think about what activities you're doing in each quadrant. Are you only doing hard science stuff, or are you only doing maybe interior things?
So we could say it's like a life philosophy.
It's a theory. So with a theory, you do whatever you want. Mm-hmm. You can make it as a life philosophy, or you can just enjoy it, or you can do whatever you want with a theory. But integral life practice is a suggestion of what practices you can put into your life. But then your life philosophy depends on your beliefs and your what you want to do.
And do you have a concrete example of somebody who used that to
Me? I'd say I know that integral theory has been used even by personalities such as Bill Clinton and so on. I don't know if he uses it for his life, but at least for his political planning, he uses it. Other than that, for more personal development, I do not have any example in mind. Yeah. So, if we had one thing to remember from this whole presentation, is that integral theory is also about understanding that as humans evolve, our consciousness evolves. And so it's all about the evolution of consciousness. And as much as Edgar Morin brought a lot to bring the fields together, the different approach that Wilber has is that he integrates even spirituality and consciousness, whereas from my understanding, Morin stays more into systems and how things work together. So if we had to simplify things, we could say that maybe systems theory and Edgar Morin's complexity theory would be in the lower right quadrant and would be integrated into a larger framework. Although I'm sure that Edgar Morin has some beliefs, but I think that in his work he maybe distanciates from his personal beliefs, whereas Wilber prefers to dive straight into it.
Just make clear, he integrates a lot his own subjectivity the understanding he has of getting information by systems is reflexivity. So there is a continuous process from biological systems, let's say, until what Wilber would call consciousness. So I think they're close to the sentence.
Okay, so I do believe they're close, and I think it's more about the correlation that Morin will use, as you say, the systems theory and the biology explanations to that we need to correlate with the consciousness, and he uses his own subjectivity to do it. Yeah. So to conclude, basically integral theory is about seeing the world as a whole. And I simply chose, instead of making my own conclusion, to read one small passage of Ken Wilber this time, just to conclude. And I use it as a conclusion, but that's part of the introduction of the theory of everything. This book is a brief overview of the theory of everything. All such attempts, of course, are marked by the many ways in which they fail. The many ways in which they fall short, make unwarranted generalizations, drive specialists insane, and generally fail to achieve their stated aim of holistic embrace. It's not just that the task is beyond any one human mind. It's that the task itself is inherently undoable. Knowledge expands faster than ways to categorize it. The holistic quest is an ever-receding dream, a horizon that constantly retreats as we approach it, a pot of gold at the end of a rainbow that we will never reach. So why even attempt the impossible? Because I believe a little bit of wholeness is better than none at all, and an integral vision offers considerably more wholeness than the slice and dice alternatives. We can be more whole or less whole, more fragmented or less fragmented, more alienated or less alienated. And an integral vision invites us to be a little more whole, a little less fragmented in our work, our lives, our destiny. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We could have had some copies of the books to buy them now.
Yes, and I went to see Thierry, and he might have some at the bookstore. I don't know if they arrived yet. But
Thierry Leguera at the bookstore?
Yes.
Good.
Sorry about the books, and this was the book I mentioned earlier was Sex, Ecology and Spirituality, and that's his masterpiece. It has not been translated to French yet. That tells pretty much a lot about integral theory. But otherwise, I would recommend A Theory of Everything, which has been translated into French. And this is a good introduction and simple way to see the overall theory.
These have been translated?
Yes.
Which publisher?
It's not a very mainstream publisher. I forgot which one it is. But